You can do better than this. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I don't know whether I truly deserve the words expressed by Dr. Shalini and my friend for the last 30 years, Sudhish Chaudhary. Tell you one thing, not what they spoke and the way they described me was good or excellent, but I thought I will share with you a very unique type of introduction someone had for me once, and I would describe that introduction as more creative. So this introduction is more descriptive. Please allow me to share this story with you. My first day at the Kellogg School was September 11, 2001, as the dean. Just imagine the day I started my job. Can you all hear me? So that morning at 8:30, I had to welcome 600 students, which is the size of our full-time MBA program. And that was my first time with the students. So I asked our previous dean, Tom Jacobs, who was the dean of Kellogg for 26 years. I said, Dean Jacobs, why don't you start the morning? So he spoke from 8:30 to 8:45 in the morning. 8:45 I was introduced. And then I made my speech, and about 10 or 12 minutes into my presentation, our director of corporate communications came and spoke in my ears and said, Dean Jain, there has been a terrorist attack on the US soil. That was the time when the first plane hit the World Trade Center. And you need to shut up before the cell phones start ringing. You know this? Now, just imagine, who would have ever anticipated an event of that type? And you start the first day as the dean of the school welcoming the students. Anyway, you cannot change what has happened. So we had to stop the event. And I went back to my office. And then, that afternoon, someone came to see me. You all know the name, Professor Philip Kotler. He was a colleague of mine. So Professor Kotler, I always called him Professor Kotler. He said, Dipak, very sorry to hear what has happened today, but actually I was planning to come and see you irrespective of this event, and I need a favor for you. I said, Professor Kotler, what can I do for you? He said that I have been invited to give a talk, and this talk is for close to 3,000 people. You know, he speaks like a public speaker, and he said the day of the talk happens to be the day when my son-in-law would have a major surgery. His son-in-law was involved in a very serious accident, close to being paralyzed, and the doctor has set that particular the same day when he was supposed to give the seminar. So he said, would you substitute for me? I said, Professor, why you want to put me in such an awkward situation? The world is coming to listen to Professor Kotler. Why should you put me? He said, what do you have as a suggestion? I said, you have the best excuse in the world today. You can go to the organizer and say, given September 11 has happened, don't use that as the only excuse. You can say that if you can change the date, because people will understand this has happened. So he said, let me talk to the organizer. So the organizer came back and said, Professor Kotler, 3,000 people have already registered, and if you change the date, not everyone can meet on the next date, and then you have to return the money because this is like a paid seminar. So he said it would be a logistical nightmare to do a change. So the head of this organization said, why don't you send someone else? So Professor Kotler comes back to me and said, Dipak, you have to do it. I said, I'm not going to say no to you. So I flew to this place. So the talk was at 9 in the morning. It was a whole day seminar. And at 8 o'clock, I had to meet the chief organizer for breakfast. Actually, when he looked at me, he almost had a heart attack. He said, is this guy going to speak to 3,000 people? So he asked me, what do you do? Professor Kotler only told him that I'm going to send a colleague of mine, but didn't give him any description who this person is. And this guy must have thought that he would be some very well-renowned professor and other thing, and he looks at me and... So I said that until recently, I was a professor of marketing, a colleague of Professor Kotler, and now I am the dean of the school. He was not an academic, so he didn't know what it meant to be the dean. So he asked me, what do you do as a dean? So I started explaining that as the dean of the school, you set the directions for the school, you think what programs would be the right ones, you build relations with the corporations. Because I really believe that if you have to think of a business school, there are three elements you need to emphasize. One is, of course, academic excellence, but then comes business relevance. And third, and this is more post September 11th, I think today we also have to emphasize social significance. Because we have a responsibility for the society also. So I think that we do business relevance, but we also try to connect with the government. And particularly at Kellogg, we were very close to the not-for-profit organizations. So I said that this I do. In addition, I said there is a very important role the dean plays, and that is the dean is involved in promotion of faculty members. The hiring gets done by the department, but then faculty members have to go through a 10-year process, and the 10-year decision eventually is done by the dean's office. So I said, in some sense, the faculty at the school, they report to the dean. So my role as the dean is like the chief executive officer of a company, except the salaries are very different. I said that we are not in the same league as the CEO of a company. This is the truth. So he said, now I know how to introduce you. Till then, he didn't ask me what my name was. I didn't have any new business cards, and neither he had any card. He said, I know how to introduce. So after the breakfast, he comes to the podium, big hall. He came, he said, good morning. Everyone said, good morning. He asked the audience, how many of you have heard the name Philip Kotler? All the hands went up. He told the audience, today I present to you the boss of Philip Kotler. Right, that was the only introduction he had. Standing there was very special for a person who grew up in a small town in Tejpur, Assam, where we didn't have any university, nothing, to be one day described or introduced as the professor and the boss of Phil Kotler. That goes back to whom we are. There is a word I use quite a lot in my speech, which I call the Indian sanskars. There is no real word, English meaning of the word sanskar. You can call it core values or whatever it is. But we all have something in us which is very unique, and these sanskars come from our parents, from our teachers. And I want to tell all of you, never feel yourself inferior to anyone. I never thought a day would come when I would be asked to be the head of the Kellogg school, and not only that, where Kotler, I had the pleasure of writing a book with. So my first advice to all the students here in the room is, never compromise for anything lower than excellence. We all have the attributes in us. Strive for it. Just like Nike says, just do it, just try it. And we all, no matter where you grow up, I had never the chance to go to any IITs or any IIMs in the world, neither the father could support nor had any resources. And if a person growing up in such a situation can reach where I am today, you have a great future ahead of us. Okay? So with those words, again, Shalini, thank you, Sunil, and my dear friend, Professor, I will call him Professor Sumant Bakshi. We met in March this year, and somehow or other, that was a special evening, we sat on the same table together, and then both Dr. Earth and Professor Bakshi said, would you mind coming and visiting the campus? and I have been looking for that moment, and then today it happens to be the day. But I want to sincerely apologize for delaying you all for being here on a Sunday. You decided to come, and then also the talk started late. But I will do my best for what I have to cover in this topic. As Shalini said, let me use the name Shalini, okay? Question. Management education started, as she said, in the 1900s. The oldest business school offering an MBA degree happens to be Dartmouth. But the actual business education, the oldest school happens to be the Wharton School. But they started with undergraduate education. And their undergraduate education was more economics with business included. But the word MBA actually comes from Dartmouth. Two schools emerged in 1908. One was the Harvard Business School, and other was the Kellogg School. Both started in 1908. Harvard in April of 1908, and we started in the fall. So between 1900 to 1908, it was only Dartmouth. And between 1908 to 1920, lots of schools emerged, including Stanford, others. So what you have today, in a real sense, I would say, using the word 1915 to 2015, 100 years of excellence in management education. Because when schools start and then they build the programs and others. So if you look at the world and think about 100 plus, but 100 years of really, I would say, glorified management education, we are in a state where I think management education is really going to be essential for people to become leaders. In fact, just like we used to call business MBA, business administration, now many people don't like the word business administration, they like the word more management, because management includes business and also non-businesses like public not-for-profit. The next thing would be that people may start calling schools of leadership. Because management is one function, but then you move from management to leadership. So how schools need to emerge, and I will give you a chronological order of how businesses have evolved and how business education has evolved. And in terms of, when you look at the management school, we have three missions. The first is knowledge creation. And knowledge creation, Sudhi knows, we professors are expected to do research. Research can be both theoretical and applied. Applied research means you can look at industry problems specifically. And case studies also come under the category of applied research. This is something necessary for faculty members, because we are promoted based on our research productivity. And one way to emphasize research is through PhD programs, where we recruit students who are not only MBA students but PhD students. They work with faculty members, and a lot of publications for faculty members come jointly with their doctoral students. So this is the first mission. The second we call it knowledge dissemination. You produce the knowledge, but now you need to spread this knowledge. And the dissemination comes from the different programs we have. Like I said, PhD is one program, but the most popular happens to be MBA or Executive MBA, and now also the BBA, the bachelor's part. Personally, I believe that management education, the enduring value, would be more on the postgraduate side. Because students can come from different disciplines in their undergraduate. But what you need to know is what are the essentials of management for you to go up in the corporate ladder. So that is knowledge dissemination, means different programs. The third is knowledge certification. MYRA School of Business, Kellogg School of Business, School of Management, we have one additional mission, that we have the authority to award you a degree. Many institutions like the McKinsey's of the world, Center of Creative Leadership, they can also do one and two. They also do research, they also publish papers, but they cannot certify an MBA degree. That's only the privilege that is there for business schools, universities and others. So all of you in this room, under the umbrella of MYRA School of Business, you have all three missions accomplished. And one advice I would give, even if you graduate, you can work with faculty members in writing cases for the companies that you go to work for, because that would be very useful, because you are in a position where you can have access to information and professor can guide you, because you have been used to such cases. And if there are good Indian cases, I tell you, that would be one way for foreign universities to know more about India, because the best way to disseminate knowledge is through using case studies. And for a professor from a US university to write a case on India is difficult than for us, because we have links to many corporations and so on. So this is what we are. A new evolving mission is what I call knowledge monetization. Knowledge monetization, people go and work for consulting firms. They charge very significant amount for any company. I think time has come for business schools to take the same role, where students work with, under the guidance of professors, and do projects for corporations. You, to me, management education has to follow the principles of medical education. In medicine, you get the degree, but then you have to work as what they call an intern or something when you do this part, until you become a full-fledged doctor. And what is the role of the internship? You actually work with the senior doctors. If you are going to be a surgeon, you observe them doing the surgery and others. So here also, we believe that if business schools can have relations with corporations and students or even alumni, work together on some specific projects for these schools. And what these companies would do is to give money to the school. Part of that money can be given to faculty members for their research, because otherwise funding is going to be a problem for management schools. Management schools cannot run just based on tuition revenue, because that's not, with all the cost structure, the tuition alone cannot support management schools. So we need to have additional sources of revenue, and I think knowledge monetization is one way where you build good relations with the corporations. And there, I tell you, the quality of the project would be far better or as good as the consulting firm. Because in consulting firm, who does the project? The same MBAs who just graduated, except that they have a different brand name. But it is the same people doing this. So I think that more and more connections we should build with corporations as we move forward. First, for the school, there is a revenue source. And for the student, it's a great learning experience, because you would know the concepts that we teach in the classroom, how you apply those concepts to real life. Why in the school? So that's like business lab, or we call business practicums. So you learn this part. Now I want to share with you how management education of businesses have evolved over time. So I will talk about the time period, what the focus, who were the players, and what the impact. One thing I tell people, that if you have to think, always think big. So last 3 years, I was telling Sudhi, has been quite personally challenging for me. It was in 2012, month of February, when I was diagnosed with brain tumor with cancer. So I had my brain surgery in April of 2019, and the person who operated me was a student of mine in 1996. He was an executive MBA student, and he was a chief of anesthesia and chief surgeon. And he operated me, and he did such a fine surgery. My tumor was between in the very deep in the speech and memory area. I lost a lot of memory, but he kept the speech alive, because he knew I was a professor. You could see that what level of surgery it was done. But then I recovered, and things started recovering. But last year, the side effects started. And the side effects is, since I was on steroids for 9 months, the steroids affected my bone joints. So now, how I walk with a stick is, my right hip is dead. So I have to go for a total hip replacement. So I was telling my surgeon the other day, the earlier I had trouble with my head office, now I have trouble with my back office. But the front office is fine, so I can just tell you. So while I was recovering, I was thinking about this concept of business. And I tell you my views, and if you have any other... If you look up to the 19th century, the business model I would describe as a model of colonialism. The players were countries. What did these players do? They went and acquired other countries. We all were under the rule of the British. I remember in 1962 when I was in school, in those days still in Assam, there were a lot of foreigners because Assam was famous for tea and the tea gardens were mostly run by the British, and their spouses and their others were associated with many English schools, and there was a very famous saying that the sun never sets on the British Empire. So the players in those days were countries, and today if you look at, we have a concept called outsourcing. In those days also it was not only outsourcing, they went and acquired the whole country, right? That's all what it was, because the countries they acquired were rich in resources. But what was the problem? We did not have our act together. The act together means they took advantage that there are a lot of inner conflicts, and that's what UK did, Spain, France. If you see, mostly the players came from Europe because America was still not yet fully developed. And the way they were measured is the strength, how many countries you had as your colonies. And that stayed, I would say, for many years. Then a country came, United States got independent in 1776, but most of the developments happened in the 1800s. And they shifted the model from colonialism to capitalism. And the word capitalism came in those days. The very famous book that starts is Adam Smith, where he very clearly mentioned that the butcher or the baker, they have their self-interest when they are serving you. And the point was that businesses can only be sustainable if you create value for both the producer and the consumer. Which in today in game theory they would say win-win situation and others, that was formalized later. And this was a very significant shift in the needle. And this period the country started becoming independent. We got our independence in 1947, but this 1900, I would say from 1800 onwards, when the capitalism thing started, I have a personal view that really motivated a lot of individuals in other countries also, that if we can do so much, the independence movement is not completely independent. It also affected people saying that why are these people only enjoying all the benefits? Let's empower our own citizens. You may have heard the name Milton Friedman. He is a very famous economist from the University of Chicago. And actually after Adam Smith, Adam Smith was in the 1800s, in 1900s a person, if he really promoted this concept, and I really believe that Milton Friedman added a lot to management education, was his belief in capitalism. When I became the dean, I had a great desire to meet him, because you know, he really believes that most efficient organizations are private organizations. I don't know whether you have read this, but there is a very famous quote I read about Milton Friedman, and he once said that if you let the government run the Sahara Desert, in 5 years there will be shortage of sand. That's how you think the governments are so efficient. In 5 years there will be shortage of sand. So I thought that let's meet this management guru. And one of my alum said, Dr. Jain, I can help you on this. I know him personally. So I went to see him in San Francisco. He lives there. We flew from Chicago. And we thought we would meet with him. Now at that time, I think he was 91, going to be 92 years old. So we decided to have lunch together, because people at that age, they're by 5:30 or so, they are already in the bed. So I thought that lunch would be the best thing to do. So we had booked the reservation at Bohemian Club in San Francisco. So he brought his wife, me and my friend, four of us went there, and we had made reservation. I said, this is 2003. the club denied us entrance. Women not allowed. Just imagine San Francisco. Of all the places on the planet, I would have never thought. It was an embarrassment for me. I never thought of checking this. And they said that Mrs. Friedman cannot go. Now we are not going to eat lunch. This is there. So then I told Dr. Friedman, I said, let's go and eat somewhere, wherever you like. Because it was not the physical food, but the intellectual food. So I met with him. And he took us to a place. And the owner, when he saw him, said, Dr. Friedman, good to have you here. Would you like us to prepare the same fish that you like for your guest? This is just like as if he's going to a personal place. So we sat down and I asked him this question. I said that today we talk a lot about social responsibility. What's your view on that? And since September 11th that happened, so the needle has shifted. You know what he said? He really said the only social responsibility of business is to make profits. He said that is, his point is, if you don't make profits, you don't have resources to do something for the society. So the essential point is, profits means corporations should create value. Now how you distribute that value to the community and the society is the second step. Don't be an idealist, which means the impact is success, and success is measured by either the share price or the profits you make. If you look at the world today, I think today we are in the stage of the core essence is human capital. People like you in the room. Products are not going to be differentiated. Somebody can come and make the same product. They can match the price. They can match the channels. Everything that we learn in business can be copied. The real differentiation, I think, for corporations would be the quality of people you have. Human capital, and among human capital, I think we are in the era of entrepreneurialism. And why I say that is, just go back for the last 35, 40 years. Who are the giants in the industry today? You hear the name Bill Gates. In our lifetime, Sudhir knows, Microsoft was nothing in the early 80s. He created a huge corporation as an entrepreneur. You hear about Michael Dell. You hear all the stories about garages being the source of such things. Today you see Facebook. In India you see Flipkart and what is Snapdeal or others. This is your age. This is not the age driven by large corporations. This is the age of citizens. So the players are now, corporations are there, but rather than I say entrepreneurship, there is a word we use called intrapreneurship. Corporations, when they hire new people, they need to think of a concept like called reverse mentoring. You need to, senior people need to sit down with the young generation and see what new ideas you are bringing to us. Because you have lots of creative ideas, corporations have resources. So one way to do for corporation is to hire young talent and create new products and new opportunities. And if corporations are not doing that, you go and seek the venture capital and the people who are willing to put the money. And that's why Silicon Valley became what it is today, because they promoted this concept of entrepreneurialism, or what I would say human capital development. And as I said, the young generation, for them, the metric is no longer just success, it's also significance. What is Bill Gates doing today? Spending his time on making human life better. All the projects he's doing in Africa and other that is there. Mark Zuckerberg also is doing a lot. You hear about Azim Premji, his foundation. But my advice to all of you is, for you to do anything, you need to be first successful. Don't be an idealist that you want to go and work in a village and do these things, because you have to establish your success platform first. Then you have a responsibility, what you can do for your village, what you can do for the town you grew, what you do for your community. So when I was the dean of the Kellogg school, and as you know, all schools, you come up with some kind of a branding for the school. My advice to my student was that by joining Kellogg School, you are starting your journey from success to significance. That was the brand of Kellogg. Kellogg means from success to significance, but you ought to be first successful. That is a necessary condition. First work, create an identity for you, whether you want to be an entrepreneur or you go and work for any company and others, that is a necessary condition. And I would strongly urge you that if you have ideas, build on those ideas, and today you need to work collectively. A lot of these projects that come are classmates who work together with the help of the faculty member that you have here. And for faculty members also, they can learn from the new generation. Because when we started teaching, I really see a big difference today. When I taught at INSEAD in 2013 and I taught at Kellogg in 1986-87, there is a shift in the student body. You call them the millennials or whatever it is. Students today have access to more information because of the internet than had previously. And people can do a lot. And just a story comes to my mind. I have said this story many times, but I want to say it once again because I want to listen to it. So I tell you, I come to Kellogg School. I did not have a background in marketing. Kellogg School is known as the School of Marketing and others. My PhD was in applied mathematics, an area called operations research, and within operations research also something to do with stochastic processes. My bachelor's degree is in mathematics honors, master's in mathematical statistics from Guwahati. And so the marketing department didn't know what courses they can give me to teach. So the only course they thought would be closest to this is market research, because marketing research involves a lot of statistics. So my chairman said, he asked me to teach marketing management, and I said, I don't even know what segmentation, targeting, and positioning. These were new words to me. So I had to teach. So I had two sections. Our classes at Kellogg are 1 hour 40 minutes, one session. So I taught them. So we teach Monday, Thursday, or Tuesday, Friday. So I had two sections. In one, about 30 plus students. In another, 28, 29. Since I was new, many students didn't want to take my class, but they had to take it because it was a required course for all marketing majors. So I taught my first class on Monday. I taught my second class on Thursday. So we teach from 1 to 4:40, and then from 1 to 2:40, and 3 to 4:40, and 5 to 6 office hours. So I came back on Thursday at 5 o'clock. A couple of students came to see. So there were some students sitting outside the office, and there were three who came in front and said, "Professor, can we meet with you?" I said, "Yes, please come in." So I tell you the names. The first person, his name was Fred Kindle. Later on, he became the chairman of a company called ABB, a Swiss company. He became the chairman. The second person, I could not reveal the name because I promised him. He used to work for Coca-Cola, came to Kellogg School. And the reason is, in the very first class, he said something that didn't make sense. So I asked him to come to the blackboard. In those days, we didn't have PowerPoint presentation. I'm talking about in the 80s. I asked him to explain what he was saying. He felt that as an insult. Next day I had a letter from his neurologist saying that I put his patient into depression. My chairman called me in the office and said, "This is not the..." I come from India. My chairman called me and said, "You don't do these things here." It is not a lesson, but he also came. And the third person, name was John Nielsen. And John Nielsen in 1982-83 worked for Microsoft. In my view, he would have succeeded Bill Gates in spite of Steve Ballmer, but he died very early. He had leukemia. He and his wife and Bill Gates and Melinda Gates were very close friends. So these three people came in the room, the rest were sitting outside. And Fred Kendall says, "Professor, we want to tell you what we students feel about your class. So we want to give you some feedback." So he started saying, "Professor, we both students, that means the both sections, we all met and we have come to the conclusion that you don't know the subject." Very openly, without any missing any words, he said, "Professor, it seems that you don't know this subject." And there is some truth to it, I cannot deny. So I'm a very open person. I said that there is some truth to it, but you know, remember one thing. Outcome is the sign. You see what he's saying. The process to reach the outcome is the insight. So I wanted to ask him, how did you come to this conclusion? In just two classes, I have 18 more to go. We have 20 sessions of one course. And I said, just in two classes, how did you all figure this out? That's, to me, an act of genius, right? That they figured it out so soon. So I asked him. So this guy from Coca-Cola tells me, he says, Professor, let me tell you why we feel in this way. I said, tell me. He said, Professor, what you spoke in the two classes, basically you read the first four chapters of the book. But you read it very well. My style is I don't use any notes or others. I use blackboard and chalk to teach. He said, you just read the four chapters very well. All the examples you gave were the examples in the book. And these chapters were meant for us to read before the class. So we had done the reading, so we didn't learn anything new. So we think your knowledge is just limited to you reading something and repeating in the class. Good logic. There is nothing wrong. So I was just explaining him that this is true. I am talking to the senior professors. And I am just starting a new phase of my life. Before that, I was a professor, but teaching quantitative methods, statistics. So then by the time I was giving some explanation, this guy, John Nielsen, he says, Professor, by the way, we have not come here to complain. The tone didn't seem like that. He says, Professor, by the way, we have not come here to complain. So I said, what's the purpose? He said, something very emotional. He said, Professor, we all students feel there is a great teacher inside you. And this evening is our promise. We will make you the best teacher of market research. No challenge ahead of you is greater than the force behind you. And what they did was, from next day, they used to get cuttings from Wall Street Journal, Business Week, and others, any marketing story. Every morning there would be a bunch of stories, and the professor said, they said, Professor, when you explain the concepts, start weaving these stories. First quarter was tough, but I tell you, from 88 till 92, when I came in the dean's office, there was not a single year I was not nominated as one of the top five professors. I was always the bridesmaid, never the bride, never got the final award, but at least in that set. So my suggestion to the teachers here is, when students give feedback, feedback means you want the other side to improve. But feedback also has to be genuine. And these students I am still in touch with, because we are in this business together. You bring your experience to the room, we bring our expertise. So a classroom is a platform for exchange. And that has tremendously helped me in my years in connection to the student body that I had. So today, the programs cannot be just the business programs. We also need to have these other courses there. And a strong emphasis on not only business entrepreneurship, but also social entrepreneurship. Because a lot of people would like to go and work for such organization. So as I said at the beginning, you need to have academic rigor or academic excellence, business relevance, and results means something of social significance. So how do you do this? Please show me the hand when I need to share. Okay, what is this? So when you think of business schools, and you come and select a school, our currency is not bank balance. Because on that dimension, we cannot compete with the Harvards and the others. US schools have something that we don't have in Asia and Europe, and that is alumni giving yet. Because if you look at the success of US schools, our biggest source of revenue is alumni giving. People give back to the school because they think the school made a difference in their life, and that's why they give. Harvard endowment, we gained several billions of dollars. When I was a dean of Kellogg, we grew from 300 million when I took over to about close to 750 million. And we used that money to bring new programs, bring faculty members, and our job is to invest it back in the school. So I always tell that reputation is our currency, and for reputation, you have three ways to build reputation. One is, I call input, one is throughput, and one is output. Input means attracting quality students. So I'm very pleased the students who you have decided to join us is the input quality. India is blessed that we don't have an issue with input quality. There are so many people seeking and there are so many brilliant students. That is the second dimension of reputation is throughput. And throughput means curriculum and faculty. Because now when you are entered, what do you see? The curriculum, whether it is MBA, it is executive MBA, whatever it is, and the faculty members that you get in touch with. And output is the quality of placement, where you have relations with the companies with whom you work with, and then those successful alum, they become part of the alumni community. So, given MYRA is just has a history of less than almost 3 years or so, but we need to make sure that when we hire students, your brand is not the promise, but the delivery of the promise. And that's how we have to integrate that part. The second is differentiation. India is full of business schools, so is many other schools in the world. So our challenge is, how do we differentiate? And one differentiation may be that at MYRA, we have something that other business schools are not offering. There can be one way to do these things. You create some new courses or some new programs, and that is something, it would evolve over time, and you also, when students graduate, can say that this is something missing in this region. We can think of creating some courses or some kind of pedagogical tool that can help us differentiate. The disruptive pedagogical tool, normally the standard pedagogical tool is you study case studies. A very easy way people do. Now people have started doing a lot of simulation exercises. Like what if scenario and many other such programs, people would do that. That becomes one. And the fourth, of course, is what business are we? What is the mission of a business school? We are in the business of creating leaders who are going to make significance in terms of world peace and prosperity. So how do we accomplish these things? Is I will tell you how we teach such things in business schools. If you look at any company you go to work with, company's reputation comes from three things. Growth. You look at, is this a company growing? And you always would see the publication growing at 15%, 20%, 100%, whatever it is. The second is innovation. What's new this company is bringing to the marketplace? And whom would you like to go and work for? Companies that are very innovative, rather than going and working for the traditional companies, because you think in new innovative companies, you have more opportunities and more creativity. So first is growth, second is innovation, and third is leadership. And leadership includes the human capital part, because I really believe that people connect with people. And people don't leave companies, they leave the person. So when somebody leaves a company, you're not leaving the company, you're leaving because of the person you were working with, either the body chemistry didn't work, and sometimes you leave company X and you join Y, you are the same person, you're very happy there. This is just like, I always tell people that one person gets a divorce and she becomes the sweetheart of the other person. The person is the same. With one you cannot work with and then you become the sweetheart of the other. At the end, it's all about the body chemistry, how you work. So we as human beings, when we think of building business schools, we have to think of the leadership aspect. The people that you are going to work with, because those people should help you become more productive rather than less. And this is where sometimes in the Indian culture, being the society very hierarchical, I think time would come where there would be this concept of reverse mentoring that you would hear from the others. That is a cultural part, but let's focus on the innovation part. So my advice to some of you is that when we think of innovation, normally we think of innovation as new products. So people would think, what are the innovative companies? Apple, Google, just a standard example, they are coming with iPhone 6, Google coming with this and so on. That type of innovation is very expensive, because you require billions of dollars, and many of the Indian corporations are not willing to do that investment. The other area is pharmaceuticals, and that's also you take out billions of dollars. So most of the Indian pharmaceutical companies are not in producing new drugs, but generics they do, which is the molecule has already been discovered and you produce that. So that is, to me, not an area where many of you can make an impact. And just be very realistic. The second type of innovation is what I call process innovation. So you get the same thing but at a different process. Like in old days when you go to the airport, you stand in the line, you get your boarding card, and then you go board the plane. Now you can have the boarding card electronically delivered to you. You don't have to have the paper copy. You can put the BlackBerry or the iPhone right there and you connect. So the product is still the boarding card, but it's a different process electronically you have get, and that came because of the internet. I am now focusing more on the third innovation, which I called business model innovation. And what is an example of business model innovation? I am suggesting airlines that rather than selling tickets, they should start selling miles. If you look at airlines, I don't know here in India, but in US, flyers are very emotionally attached to the mileage program. All airlines have these frequent flyer programs. So people who fly a lot, if you fly more than 100,000 miles, you get the highest status, which is called, in United Airlines, you're going to Bangkok, some platinum status. If you fly less, you still have some status. And if you become a high level flyer, what happens? You get more benefits, you have access to lounges. If there is opportunity, they upgrade you from economy to business class. Nothing wrong with that. So, now my proposition to airlines is, why not start selling miles? And I know I have to fly 100,000. I can buy 100,000 miles upfront. I get a card with that miles. You go to the airport, you scan the card. If, depending on the distance, they can detect the miles. And it is not only a function of distance, but it's also a function of the timing. If you are flying on a very priority time, the miles can have a different, I can deduct a different miles than if you are traveling at a less crowded, because you know in airlines also the prices are there. So I have come up with a model, a new business model, that rather than selling tickets, sell miles. Now what is good? Always remember one rule of business. Any proposition you do has to be a win-win situation. Win for the user and win for the provider. This zero-sum game thing that we teach in game theory is only in textbook. That doesn't work in real life. Now, what is the win for the user? I got my 100,000 miles status day one. So now once I have that status, I have that card, if I go to the airport, I have access to lounge, I have access to many facilities, upgrade and everything. Because I earned the status day one rather than waiting for the year to have it. What is good for the airline? They got the money up front. Now whether you use the ticket or not, that's not my concern. So you can also do better planning because you know these people are going to use. So one thing that we teach in inventory management, in airlines this inventory management is more critical because you cannot storage the inventory. The moment a plane takes off, the empty seat gives you zero revenue. So my concept is, rather than selling smiles, we need to sell miles. Because people are very emotionally attached to the mileage program. This is the kind of innovation. To textbook publishers, I have been saying, rather than selling books, start selling chapters. Many publishers are complaining to me that in India and China, people don't buy books, they make photocopies. Now when you make photocopies, what is the revenue to the publisher? Zero. What is the revenue to the author? And the point is, look at the book like Philip Kotler. Its actual price in US, I don't know in India what it is, in US it is about $220. $220 for one book would be equal to the monthly salary for many people in India. So what do people do? When they photocopy, it's an economic necessity, not that people want to do that. So what it is there, rather than selling the book, sell chapters, there is legally you can photocopy X number of pages. That is legal. So if your chapter is of the same size, I buy one chapter, the other student buy one chapter, the other person buy one chapter, and now you can make photocopies of that chapter, that is legal, plus people can afford to buy a chapter. This way what happens? When I buy a chapter, you will electronically send me the chapter. What is the cost to the publisher? Who is going to print? The student. So whose paper is being used? Student. What is the cost to the publisher? Just sending the email, which is basically close to zero. You will print and then you can share with your classmates and others. what I mean to say is the future would be the more you can discretize a product, like people selling songs rather than the whole album. So this is the future. So if you have to think of new businesses, think businesses that can be discretized would be one very good way to create new entrepreneurship. Any business that can be discretized to units, books, to chapters, and the next would be not chapters, but I would only need these pages. Because in books you have the new edition, you look at the old edition, you have the old edition, you don't have only these pages, I buy only these new pages. And this is again a win-win situation, because otherwise the publisher, no, the people would do photocopy. If I come to that level, then the volume would increase. Some people would be buying this chapter, another chapter, and so on, and that way you will keep this. The third industry is the newspaper industry. In many places, newspapers are becoming extinct. Right? People are not reading, they wrote. By the time you get the newspaper, and the newspaper headline is 4 dead, 67 injured, you have heard that thing 67 times on TV and others. So those headlines have very little meaning. I am telling newspapers, just like airlines, that from smiles you move to miles, newspapers should move from news to views. And what is views? The event has happened, all of us have heard, a plane was shot down, something happened in with the ISIS and others. What the newspaper should do is to provide views. What are the social and economic implications of this event? And for this, invite opinions from readers. Who would not like to see his or her name in the newspaper on the picture? People would love to do that. So newspapers should be like inviting readers to provide stories, and rather than having all these editors, have a person who would edit these stories, and the newspaper is filled with views from different segments. Today I hear views from people from academia, people from business people, some social scientists, and that's we. People like to see the implications of how it would affect the economy. So from news, we should move to news. I really believe that India can excel on this. Because for this, you don't need the billions of dollars of investment. The only investment you need is a new way of thinking or critical thinking. Lots of such things can be done. Because one thing that I can tell you we all excel is one very important thing, and that is our parents' commitment to education. If there is one thing that differentiates India, I agree with many countries, our parents, their first priority is give the best education to the children. They start getting worried all the way from kindergarten. Whenever I come in, they say, my children, what would you suggest after high school, whether they should go to US here, study here? And this is something very unique. And so long this flame is alive, we will go places. Because the push, and our parents have a language of sacrifice. They are not that much interested in taking a vacation as much as in seeing how they can put the savings into education. And if that flame keeps illuminating, I think the best is ahead of us. And I come from a family, not to tell you much, my father was blind and my mother was completely uneducated. Hardly went up to third or fourth grade. She used to wake up at 4 in the morning and say from 4 to 6 before the world gets polluted. In those days there were no TV and others, I'm talking of 62, 63. Just do your homework between 4 and 6 in the morning. 6 o'clock we used to go to the well, drink some buckets of water, there was no running water in those days. Then get ready, take a shower, go to school and come. But she made sure to give us a cup of tea in the morning and some biscuits and work. And that commitment is what makes India unique. Because you don't see that level of commitment in many countries. So if we have that commitment from our parents, then you come to schools and learn. We also have to think what we give back to the society. That's where I see more innovative practices. Even in social entrepreneurship, you can think how we promote more education. The other area would be healthcare. So there are three industries that I think which are very important for you all to think in terms of future. And then I will end. First, anything to do with new business opportunities, if you ask me, one area that is very important is anything to do with consumer wellness. Why? because we are now in an era where human, we are in the state of longevity. You all agree? The average life expectancy is increasing. So if average life expectancy is increasing, we need to think of any industry should decide to go to work. Think of this industry called consumer wellness, and under wellness I include two industries, healthcare and wealth care. Healthcare does not mean that getting sick, but how I don't make you get sick, which means prevention is better than cure. And looking at a lot of Ayurvedic drugs that you see, a lot of things in India, many new companies I have seen where they are going in the area of alternative medicine. And even within medicine, there are lots of opportunities that could come healthcare. And why wealth care? Because in India, we don't have the social security system like in the US. You have to stand on your own. With the retirement benefits or others that you have, teaching people what are mutual funds, how you make your financial, after retirement, a secure financial life, what is insurance policy, what are mutual funds and others, these are certain very important areas that would continue to grow. The second industry is consumer engagement. If people are going to live longer, post-retirement, there should be ways for them to be engaged. And this is, in this area, I think media and entertainment would be two very good areas. Because why Apple, etc. is there? This keeps you engaged all the time. Because otherwise, when people complain to me, I am overworked, I have so much work to do, I always tell them, think of the alternative. You have nothing to do that is worse than what to do. Honestly, actually, after 2 or 3 days of sleeping and all the enjoyment, you just feel completely useless and something. So media and entertainment would be another sector where I think lots of opportunities are there. And this is a growth area. And third area is consumer hospitality. If people are going to live longer, travel, tourism, restaurants, people like to go out and eat, and that is a trend that I'm seeing in many places rather than just eating at home. So anything, if you are interested in thinking, travel, tourism, restaurants, media, entertainment, healthcare, welfare are areas which, if you look at what is this Uber, again a taxi, again this is a business model innovation. They don't have any cars. What they have is a software. And what does this software do? People who have cars to people who need to be driven, they just do the connection. Airbnb, the same thing. This is your era, thinking of creative ideas and then finding sources that can help you fund those. And in this area, I really think India can make a huge difference. Because when it comes to creativity, when it comes to intellectual curiosity, we have an edge over many other cultures. Because we have grown up under difficult situations. And airplanes take off in the opposite direction of the wind. If they go in the direction of the wind, it will be gone with the wind. Right? So we need resistance in life to go up. So when difficulties come, that tells you that you think of many alternatives. And that's how minds work. So don't think that if you have difficulties, that is basically to be a lesson. And I tell people that a mistake is a mistake if repeated twice. Else it's a learning experience. Because that's how you learn. We all make mistakes, we write papers that got rejected. But once one paper gets rejected, we learn from it how we should position the other paper. So in my view to all of you, my advice is do get a job, whatever you want to do. But if there is some creativity inside you, keep talking to your friends. As I said, that this is an era of entrepreneurship. And that is what we need to promote. And your classmates, your office mates, may create new products and services. But sometimes, if you have come here, working for a corporation for a couple of years may not be a bad idea, because you learn the corporate culture. You learn something what I call work ethics. And that work ethics or work discipline is also important. Because that would help you when you start your own line of business or you work for an entrepreneurial firm, things would be not as well described as when you work for big corporations. And the other advice I would have for all of you is, don't be short-term oriented. don't think of quick profits. People who take shortcuts also cut short their lives. And if you work hard, somebody is going to notice you. That I can rest. Don't think that I'm not getting any promotion and others. People are no fools. They keep watching you, and your efforts would be rewarded. The only thing is a matter of time. I have seen this myself. Sudhi has seen that. I never became a department chair. I was not that kind of a person. I never thought that one day Dean Jacobs would come and ask me to be his deputy dean and then becoming the dean. This was the beginning of the century. Until me and another person called Abhijit Ghosh, he became the dean of University of Illinois Champaign, and I became Kellogg. Just at the beginning of this century, this was the first time when an Indian was asked to head the top business school. And all eyes were on me, because people thought, there were my own alums who came and told me, Dean Jain, the only thing I see of Kellogg is going down. I don't see any upside potential. But Dean Jacobs was so successful 26 years, and I thanked him, because I said that I was so happy he said that, because people's expectations were so low, I thought even if I do marginally better, people would think that I am genius. I set the expectations so low. But today, if you look at Harvard Business School, the Dean is there. If you look at Chicago, Sunil Kumar, and this is not for public knowledge, but I tell you, I came to Thailand for an emotional reason. Our Royal Highness came to Thailand, from Thailand to Chicago, and asked me, said that Dean Jain, I have heard a lot about you, I would like you to run my school. That another option I had was to be the Dean of Sloan. I was offered the job, I said no, and Devish Mittal was offered the job. So the best is always ahead of you, because we have some deep sanskars in us. We have deep values in us. Don't compromise on mediocrity. Do excel, work hard, believe in your teachers, believe in your parents, believe in your friends. You have one example here. Lot of people criticized me, lot of time I had difficult times, and everything that has gone wrong in the world, I happened to be there. As I said, first day was September 11, 2004. I was an advisor to the Prime Minister of Thailand, and he asked me to do a project called Branding Thailand. I made a presentation on December 18 to the full cabinet. He said, I want to do something for you, Dr. Jain. I have one proposal. Either you take your family to Phuket or to Chiang Mai in the north. I said, I will ask my wife. And they said, Chiang Mai in the north of Thailand is like Assam, where we all live. And the topography is the same. So we decided to go to Phuket. We reached there midnight of 26th morning, tsunami strikes. Me, my wife, and three children, we were standing there. Right, all the waves, we are standing there. Not a drop of water touched us. I can't tell you how I saw it. And the waves came was like Niagara Falls moving towards me. We were right out there going to the beach, and between us and there, there was a big lagoon, and all the waves gone. Ships, boats, everything came to us. But I see many times, I have seen many things. 1962, when China attacked India, they attacked my hometown, Tejpur. We ran as refugees. So from birth till today, I have seen many such things in life. That's why my friends, when they see me, they like to change their flights. I tell them, don't do that. Come with me. You will survive and have a good experience that you can share for the rest of the life. Right? My point is, as I said, difficulties come in our way to make us better, not better. Believe in the feedback. When your parents tell you, your friends tell you, your teachers tell you, they want you to excel. And there are so many business schools. We all think of how we become brand reputation differentiation that I said is there. So what's next? Whom do we serve? So I said that if you serve beyond business, society and environment, some of you may like to do something for the government. In India, that is a very major segment. As I always say, success with significance. Always think of giving back. And I give you one piece of advice. If you give X, you will get 4X back. I have learned this in life. I can tell you hundreds of stories, but one I will tell you, I was traveling. We had a program in Germany. I was going back from Frankfurt back to Chicago. Early morning flight. Our school is about 3 hours from the airport. I left at 5 o'clock. came to the airport, sat in the plane, my seat, 15C, an aisle seat. The person sitting next to me says, "Would you mind changing your seat?" That somebody was on 14B and said that there's a middle seat there, and he says, "My son is traveling with me and I haven't seen him for 9 years. He was working for the US Army. Would you mind changing your seat to 14B? Now, how many people would leave an aisle seat and get a middle seat? I said, "Fine." I said, how often a father would get 9 hours to spend with his son? So I moved to 14B. And I pressed the button and I told the faculty, the flight attendant, that I had ordered a special meal. So now I'm not on 15C but 14B. Now the 14B person, I said, there was a person on 14A. He said that, "Would you mind moving to 13? Now there is, you know, they have row, middle row, there's in the middle row there was a middle seat. He said that my wife is sitting there. Would you mind changing?" I said, "I don't want to be your wife for the rest of the 9 hours." So I didn't press, and I took the middle seat in the middle, you know, that in economy class you have three middle seats.
Yeah.
I pressed the button again for the airline, for the flight attendant. She comes back, said, "What's next?" I said, "Now I'm in 13B. She said, "Have you made up your mind?" I said, "I have, but not the other passengers." Anyway, I moved to that seat. I was tired. I just had a nap. About an hour later, somebody comes and wakes me up. He says, "Are you Dr. Dipak Jain?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I'm the chief pilot today. I was looking at the list of the passengers and you seem to be a very loyal United customer. We have a seat vacant in first class today. Why are you sitting right in the middle of a middle seat?" For the next 8 hours, I moved to first class. Had I been in a regular seat, he would have never have come to see us. So just see, I gave my seat twice and then I traveled first class, not even in business class. They took me all the way in the first class, because in first class there are some seats for the pilots and the others. So never hesitate to give. But if somebody asks you, give and you will get more from it. And then I sincerely mean it, that if I can do something, I will own it. And the other thing is, as I said at the beginning, this is an era for emerging markets. If you are working for a company when you go, and you think there are some good case studies and good industry studies you can share with, we should be in the business of knowledge creation now, which knowledge can then be used by top schools. The Harvard also, they are also interested. People are tired of listening to the same case of GE and the Microsoft and the others. If you bring some new case studies from companies here and so on, people will love it. So, for the Generation Y and others, I really believe that this is an era for us Indians to make a difference. And we have one unique characteristic, and that is proficiency in English. This is something not very minor attribute, because we can excel China, we still have a long time to do. And this, you can blame the English for many things, but they gave us something that is now going to be a valuable thing. I was telling Mr. Bakshi in the car that Newton said many years ago, to every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. In social science, to every action there is an equal and opposite delayed reaction. If there was something that England, we were under the English rule, we got exposed to English, which now happens to be the global business language. Always look for something positive in it. And there is enough you can learn. Hardships come, but we can always see some better side that we can think of relevance and independent. So, my final words to all of you is, I have, as a student, as a faculty member, I've met lots of people over life. Sudhi can say when he met me in 1987, he would have never predicted that I would be the dean of a business school. Nobody. Anything you are going to forecast is going to be wrong. But somebody is always observing you. Never ask the question. If somebody asks you to do something, never ask the question, what's in it for me? Many people are driven by these things where they bring this selfishness. And I have never, when people ask me to do something, sometimes people would say that you are just wasting time, what is there? I have always believed that when people ask you to do something, they trust you. not everyone gets to ask. So when people ask you to do something, they believe that in your commitment, they believe you have the competence, you have the character, and you will do it. And after you do three such jobs, if tomorrow there is some opening somewhere, they will remember and say, would you like to do this? So my advice to all of you is, believe in the people you work with. Don't doubt. Now, doubt is good, but doubt and curiosity are two different things. Think of the person in sincerity. And when many students tell me, the professor, the world is so big, how can I make a difference? I have only one sentence to share with you. I tell people, to the world you may be a person, but to a person you can be the world. You can make a huge difference. Dean Jacobs made a big difference in my life. You just need one person as a mentor who can help you do that. You all should feel fortunate to be in this role here. And as I said at the beginning, no challenge ahead of you is greater than the force behind you. MYRA School is behind you. Dipak Jain is behind you. I wish you the very best on the journey ahead. Thank you.
Thank you for the wonderful, highly motivating talk, sir. With your permission, I'd like to open the house for a small question and answer round.
My wife only complains about one thing. Is that Dipak, you love to speak and sometimes it shows. We are in the business of speaking, so if you don't mind, I will have a seat.
Please.
Get a glass. Give me one piece. Okay, before I open to question, this is my personal, but I learned from someone. After the dean of the school, I invited Fred Smith, who started FedEx. But I like to invite people who came for the first idea. How did they come up with this idea? FedEx is now. So he came to my office. So normally our classes end at 5. So we have guest speakers from 5:30 to 6:30. So at 5 o'clock, he came to my office. I asked, would you like to drink something? He said, can I have it? Some sparkling water. The Perrier. So I gave him a bottle of Perrier. So he said, DJ, can I have a glass? So I said, yes. So I got him a glass. So he said, I want to give you one advice. Never drink water from the bottle. He says, you put the water there because when you drink, the bubbles go inside and the bubbles slow down your digestive system. So when you put the water in the glass, the bubbles get settled, and that's a better way. So I said, I thought you were running a freight business in logistics. How did you come to this conclusion? He said, the other night I was having dinner with an Anheuser Busch. And the beer company person told him, never drink beer by the bottle, from the bottle. Always put it in the glass and drink it here, because these bottles don't help you much. So that's why I thought that many people get advice, few benefit from it. So from that day, if I get a chance, I like to drink the water from the glass rather than from the bottle. I hope I'm not causing any inconvenience, because I have to be truthful to what he taught. But really, he says that he learned from an Anheuser Busch that always try to drink from glass. Don't let the bubbles go inside the system. Open to the ask me any questions. Yes.
I am Dr. B. Gopal Singh. You are mentioning about Milton Friedman and its contribution.
Yes.
Is it the same liberalization that Friedman has said? Compared to that of this laissez-faire policy of Adam Smith and others. And he was talking about the restatement of the quantity theory of money. Regarding the restatement of the quantity theory of money, he insisted that the government should see that the money supply should be controlled. And he was mentioning about his liberalism and also the capitalistic attitude of Milton Friedman. Number one question. Number two is, you were mentioning about the scope for business, consumerism, you were telling. Is it possible that the consumerism can also be included as this consumer protection, where there is a lot of opportunity in insurance business?
Let me tell you why I brought Milton Friedman as an example. I am not an economist, so I am not getting into my thing was how his thinking influenced management education. If you look at India, and I came from Coimbatore. There is something called Isha Academy. You may have heard Sadhguru Vasudev. So he runs a 4-day program. This year I was the faculty coordinator. And one of the speakers was Narayan Murthy. Where did India brand come? In the 80s, the Wipro, the Infosys, the TCS, they came. And what was their contribution? Many people say they didn't have to go through the regular Ministry of Information and others. My point to all of you, bringing Friedman Bosman, I use the word capitalism, is he really believes that if you make businesses private, you have more control over it. Because when it is government, nobody owns it. There is no sense of ownership. And when you run your own school, Mrs. Shalini, being the founder, she has the best interest of the institution, the best interest of the student, the best interest of the public. So that, in that context, I brought Friedman, not in the quantity theory of money and others. And then this statement that I read about him, that governments are inefficient, and the point about governments being inefficient is, to me, my only personal view is, there is lack of ownership. And the ownership is so much distributed and so many layers, that within the layers, the stories get lost. But I am not an economist and I am not questioning Dr. Friedman. I just get inspired when you meet with this people. Tell you one thing. He gave me a copy from his book. So in 2001 I took over. And in 2002, when business schools were rated, Kellogg was rated the number one business school. And part of it was because in 2001, when the economy went down, I, as the dean of the school, made sure that I go and meet all the recruiters, and our placement rate was 91% that year, where other schools were not even 60%. And a lot of deans told me, Dipak, why do you have to worry about this thing? September 11th has happened, so this has happened. See, the question is, we all live under the same sky, but we have different horizons. So the problem would affect everyone, but then I took the personal liberty and I met all the recruiters and I said, do keep the log on your list. And we had a very high placement rate. So in 2003, when I met him, he also had read about me. So at the end, when I was leaving, so he got up and said, he gave me a copy of his book. He puts his arms around me and said, Dr. Jain, I want to tell you one thing. I hear a lot about Kellogg School under your leadership, but let me tell you one thing. Kellogg is no Chicago. He still believes in University of Chicago, where he did his all the work. And he said, let me make one thing clear to you. Kellogg is no Chicago, so don't get confused that you are as good as the University of Chicago. But a passion of a man of 92 at that age, that's what you have to receive. Because most of the work he did, given that he was a professor at the University of Chicago, now he retired in science. Next. Any questions? Yes.
Sir. Coming from a business family background, so should one guy go to corporate companies? I mean, or should he start his own be an entrepreneur or start his own business, or climb the corporate ladder?
I tell you all the answers I will give you are my personal opinions. Okay. My advice to most of my students is, if you get a chance to work for a corporation, do work. You could learn a lot about work ethics, corporate culture. See, you can do your own business anytime. You are the son of a businessman, you have a business. Don't encash your insurance policy today. That's the point. Go and work for someone. And I tell you this, I give you one example here. You all have known about Mr. Ambani. His daughter graduated. Made sure the doctor goes and work for McKinsey for a year, because then you learn what are the systems, processes, how they do projects. They don't need to think of salary or anything. It's more an exposure. So I always tell people that if you can get a job at a corporate level, do take it. You will meet so many people. You will see different ways how people are thinking. Sometimes you know what it gives you? Confidence. You will see that problems are not only at our place, even big companies have problems. So my advice is, if you get a chance, but don't think that is the destination. Think of it like medical education. You need to do internship. Think of that as you are doing internship in a company. With that knowledge, when you come back and do your own business, you will be a better businessman. And the second part of your question is, if even if you're doing your own business, sometimes you can start a new line of business because you may not be excited with the current line. So I meet students whose father was in a paint business or in some traditional business. You have resources to create some new platforms, but do work for a corporation.
So I should go for the US or some other countries?
Anywhere. We are all human beings. It all depends on what opportunities you get. But what your question is, should I go and work for a corporation or my own business? Now, where you go, where you end up, it's your thing. But you won't learn something. Leave him the mind.
Thank you, sir, for such a great talk. When I have attended an NGO social workshop, one great philosopher said, asked a question saying, what will you do in the purpose of life? And most of the answers end up with, first I'll take care of myself, then job, then family and society. And finally everyone ended with the society. So my question here is, correct me if I'm wrong, you said first be successful, then go for a village or any community thing. So how do you explain this?
Let me tell you what I mean by success. You all take course in marketing, and there is something we teach called branding. Now, what is branding? Branding means you create an identity. You can be, in Hindi we call an adarshwadi, an idealistic, and you think I want to go to Africa and work for some. You can go as an intern, do a year. Don't think that is your career and that age. It's a learning experience. Why I say that is, and this is my personal advice, what I'm saying for success, because you have to do something to make yourself also financially stable. Because you cannot be struggling for the rest of the life. So I did, he knows, in 2009 when I left Kellogg School, what did I do first? I helped someone establish a business, a university in Bangladesh. It's called AUW, Asian University for Women. And we target women from Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Cambodia, Vietnam and Syria. Mostly Muslim women. But normally, you know, culturally they don't go to study. And here they go for a 5-year undergraduate program. First year is an orientation because when you come from Afghanistan, these schools have different standards. They take prerequisite like basic math, basic English, then the traditional 4-year program. First year in 2009 when I went there, an Afghan girl came to me and said, Dean Jain, I want to thank you for giving us this opportunity. It's all free, by the way. We collect money from the private sector. Students pay nothing, not a single dime. And he said, thank you for giving me this opportunity because till today, until I came here, I never saw the sun. She came from the northern part of Afghanistan, always in camp. She did so well that in the second year we sent her as an exchange student to Stanford. And she graduated with a degree from AUW and a certificate from Stanford. People deserve such chance. So I spend a lot of time today in helping people who have these incentives. I don't have anything more to prove. But this person, there was a person who came to see me, he's from Bangladesh, lives at Harvard, he did his from the Harvard Law School, did a degree. He wants to give back and do something for his country. So when he comes for help, I do this. Now when I do this, what I am saying is, there is some, what is success? Success means credibility. You have some credibility, so when I go and talk to people, they would at least listen. So my point is, in any social entrepreneur, you can be there, but then you have to have some financial security either from the family or from yourself. Otherwise, you tomorrow would have a family, you would have children. Can you raise a family and do such things? That you have to think in a holistic way.
Thank you.
That's my point.
Thank you. So my question is on ethical dilemma. Sir, I never got this answer anywhere. I done my project in in-depth studies of ethical, ethical studies. So I don't know, you have every parameters to say yes, this is right, this is wrong. When it comes to ethical dilemma, you have two things which are right. How you, on your perspective, how you will judge on which parameters, which ethics, which right you have to select and which right, you have to say, no, I can't go there.
See, before answering that question, I mean, since you say this is a dilemma, very often people ask this question, are you lucky or you are so good that you became so successful? What I call is the distinction between luck and efforts. And I once read a book where Pandit Radhakrishnan, who was president, he gave a very good answer when this question was asked to him, that how do you look at luck versus effort? He said that when you play cards, the deck of cards you get is your luck. What you make of those cards is your
effort.
People with good cards can lose the game and people with ordinary cards can win the game. Because that's where your expertise comes. How good you have learned the thing. Same thing happens. What is ethics? There is no standard definition. What is ethical in one country may be unethical in others. And I give you one. I deal with this on a daily basis. In India, when we were students, I go in the 8th grade, your senior person from the 8th who went to the 9th, you get notes from them. It's not very common. Your senior students, they would give you what? You see all the notes. Now you are a chemistry student in second year of college, you have the notes from the person who graduated. This is quite common in India. In US, it is considered to be a violation of honor code. You are not supposed to get anything from previous. The student, professor asks you a question, you say what you think, not that you have read about it from others. Now this is a culture of shock. Would I say that you had access from your senior students to unethical? It can be unethical in one standard, it cannot be unethical here. Now, if you have to impose that, and suppose that Myra, Sheshadri comes and says, I would like, in honor code, you should not have access. You do what is best based on what we taught in the class, what was discussed in the class, you write your answers, don't look at other resources. Ethics is conditional. Conditional means I spell the rules of the game, and if you play within the game, with the rules of the game, you are ethical. Now, you asked another question, that if you have to have between two choices, now whether both are unethical, I don't know, or both are ethical, one thing that I use is, I have to have a sleep at night. I always take the one which I feel comfortable in. Between the two, but at the end, you have to, and if you don't feel comfortable with either, my advice would be don't go for it. But if you have to pick one, and you think this is the one, I would pick one that my consciousness would allow me. I am one of those persons, at the end, many people do lots of things. I have to ask myself, is this because tomorrow if somebody would question me, why did you do this? I need to have an answer. I need to have an answer and I have to justify I did this. But if I believe I don't have an answer, I won't pick and I will let it go. This is something that I tell you is very easy for me to stand and say. There is no standard definition of ethics and ethics is all contextual. In one context you act this way, in another context you act. And there are certain constraints. Now in some countries, bribery is accepted. In some countries, not. So there is a pharmaceutical company, Lilly, when they entered India, they found these things and they decided not to go. So they don't want to get labeled this way. So you have to ask yourself, what would be very good for you? One point, this is not of this question, but I will want to tell you is, one rule that I have followed in life, and I want to share all of you with this, I call it a 2-2-2 rule. And try to see if you can implement in your life. I call it 2-2-2 rule. Pick two industries that you are passionate about. Very good industries. In those two industries, pick two players. If you think of an industry, there may be 1,000 players, 100 players, 5 players. Pick two players. And pick two publications, like a daily newspaper or a weekly magazine, and read about these two companies on a regular basis. I promise to all of you, within 6 months to a year, you will become a world expert in those industries. Most of the people work on surface. People don't go deeper. one quality you have to build later in the life, if you become an expert, you can write a book about it. Because when you read about those two companies, you would read about the competitors also. But my two industries are airlines and pharmaceuticals. So when I read about United Airlines, or I read about Lufthansa, or I read about Indigo, they would talk about competition. And when you read about the competition, you get to know the industry. And within those two, if I am in India, I read a daily newspaper or some magazine on a regular basis, I do this part. And over time what happens, you become very knowledgeable about that. And not only knowledgeable, you can have an intelligent conversation with someone. And people would say, this person has gone deeper. And that's a very important attribute to have. Dig deeper. Don't just work on the surface.
Professor, how do you look at the scope of CSR in the management studies with specific reference to Indian context?
I would say that we are still at the lip service. By lip service, I mean that, see, this is really well done is Europe. European firms take corporate social responsibility very seriously. When I was the Dean of INSEAD, I have seen the German companies, the French companies, for them, this is a part of their corporate strategy. In many American companies also, you may say this would be, Sudhi would know this word, this is more exogenous than endogenous. Exogenous means at the end of my shareholders report, I have 2 pages on CSR, how much money I gave to this and so on. My advice to many of my friends is that when people retire, companies should use their retired people because the longevity is very long, and now move them to their corporate social responsibility initiative. Because you have already proved yourself. Rather than having a young guy go and work there, have this senior person on a part-time basis or some contract basis. Because they know the company and they can help on the CSR initiatives better because they know the company and they think now they are moving from success to significance. And that is how it should do. I think that for India, there are 2 parts. First, important is sustainability, being sensitive to the environment. But that is also very critical for us because we have limited resources, how we can be sensitive to that. And social responsibility is also important. And I have very high faith and trust with the new generation Indians. I have very high faith. I really believe, and I tell about you because I see my children, we see in the new children, they want to do something for the community, for the society. And the reason is, our children have grown in abundance. They have seen the good part. So what they like to do is to see how they can make life of others also better. So if you have many schools, you think of doing something for a village and others, what is important is when business schools have relations with corporations, we should ask corporations to donate not for other things but for CSR initiative. So when you ask the question about you want to do something for the society, those fundings can be done there. So at Kellogg, whenever we have people who want to do work for the CSR type as a career, they don't want to go and work for IBM or McKinsey, I give them a, and they had loans from the school. If they decided to go on that, I gave them the full 60,000 waiver. So they don't have to return the loan back. Because that's my commitment to CSR. So I think this is how we need to be integrated. It has to be an integral part of the corporate mission.
Sir, there's one final question on behalf of the entire MYRA community. As students, as young students who are preparing themselves to launch you know, their brand as in themselves into the market, what do you think are the key metrics that one has to track, be it both professional and personal?
See, there is no substitute to hard work. Don't think that your job is, nothing happens with 9 to 5. because all of us have to go beyond, when I say that, yeah, you have to go beyond society something. So when you are starting a job, you have to go beyond something. In early days, working hard and working sincerely creates your brand. Whatever you do, because when somebody gives you a job, what is that person expecting? That this job would be done. And it would be done in the best possible way. And if you do, if you have any problem, never hesitate to go and ask your senior about certain things, because people like to be asked. When you go and ask someone, they think you are curious and you want to improve. If there is one advice I would give you is, don't be an optimizer. Many of us optimize means, how can I do the minimum to get the job done? And they try to play games, this and that. That is not me, and that is not, I would tell you, don't underestimate the talent of the others. Sometimes we feel that we are smarter than the others. And this particular, I would say, in this room, I can say, sometimes we Indians have that feeling that we are over smart and others are idiots, or others are less smarter than us. I have always seen that others also are equally smart. They may not be smart enough to judge that particular activity, but people can see the pattern. In 1980, when I first joined Guwahati University, I was a college professor, Nagaon College, teaching mathematics. Then I got a job at Guwahati University as a professor of the management school, teaching statistics to MCOM and MBA students. Now, I was 22 years old, and these are part-time students teaching. The average age was 25, 26, because commerce students coming in the evening. And I was slightly nervous. I just completed my education. So I went to see my chair. His name was Anil Sharma. I said, Professor Sharma, do you have any piece of advice for me? And this is a big thing. You go and teach a class, and class was about 80 students. He said, Dipak, I don't know any statistics. He was the professor of organizational behavior. I said, I'm not asking for content. Just, hey, because you feel nervous. So he told me one sentence, and I have never forgotten. He said, Dipak, when your shadow becomes longer than your height, remember the sun is about to set. He said, your shadow is ego. The moment the sun sets, you will be yourself. So if you are in the class, somebody asks you a question, and you don't know the answer, don't pretend. Because tell them, you will talk to your seniors, you come back, ask the seniors. After two or three classes, you can anticipate all questions. But don't pretend something. So in workplace also, my advice is, when you are starting, nobody expects you to know everything. I was teaching a class, and a Dutch student once told me, he said, Professor, why don't you admit that you don't know the answer? There is nothing wrong with it. Sometimes we try to pretend, and that's a part of the character. So no substitute to hard work, I will tell you. And people look at your work ethics, your work habits. Outcome is not in your hand. Then we go back to the Gita days, that yes, that we cannot control the outcome, we can only control how we do things. And nothing gets unnoticed. Either good or bad, if you think you are smart enough to hide something, you can do once or twice. You make it more your habit, and the day you get exposed, then people would say that this is. So, and think of everything not as a 100 meter race, because people who run 100 meter race, they get tired. As I said, run marathon, think long term. And you will be, some people may get success 4 years, some after 14 years, it will come. You have someone sitting here, never went to an English school, I didn't even know any word of English, therefore I misspelled my name. Actually, Dipak should be written as D-double-E. I didn't know how to write English, I never went to an English school, went to US there, never studied any management. So I know to fool all the people all the time, some or other also became the dean of a management school, never had an MBA. But one thing my mother taught me very well is, if somebody asks me to do something, do with full sincerity and your happiness. My only final advice to all of you is, be sincere and respect your colleagues and respect your elders. Don't your parents, etc. Everyone thinks of you, and everyone thinks the best of you. And if you ever are in a foreign situation, I just want to tell something. always speak about your culture and share about your values to foreigners if you are in a situation. We don't know the foreign culture that way. Some people in US will talk about basketball game, baseball game, etc. When people talk to me, I always talk about my background, how I grew up. And one question last night when we were concluding the Sadhguru program, somebody asked me a question. He said, "Professor, did you have a love marriage or an arranged marriage?" They just asked the question. They were just asking. I wanted to ask him, "Do you think that nobody would have ever married me or something?" They just asked me. Now I tell you, by the time I went to US, completed my degree, I was 32 years old. Now you all know 32 is too late for a boy to get married in the country. And particularly within the Jain community, but that never happens. So honestly, my parents did not get any proposal from anyone recommending their daughter for me. So my father frankly got frustrated. So you know what he did? He put an ad in the newspaper, you know, in the matrimonials. That's how it happened. And we only got two proposals. In the whole India country, within Hindustan Times, Times of India, etc. Because who will marry a 32-year-old? So he got two proposals. And both were identical. Absolutely, what a coincidence. One was from Mysore and the other from Shillong, the two ends of the Himalayas. They both had two brothers, two sisters. They both had lost their mother at an early age. They both had a master's degree in English and they were school teachers. So they were also slightly late because normally in our Jain community you get married between 23 to 26 boys and women between 21 to 24. Two proposals. So my father and mother, they thought they would see the first one, and my father wrote a letter to me in March 1989 saying that your mom and I met and saw the first year, so Mysore person came to Delhi, they saw, and he wrote that we saw this girl and now we will go and see the other one in Shillong. And my father in that letter at the bottom wrote a sentence. He says, "My mom name is Meenu." He said, "Meenu, I really liked her." As if the decision was made, right? I called and he said that when you're, this is March, in June when classes are over, do come in summer, see the girl, this. And I read that letter, I called her father, and I said that if you have liked her so much, there is no need for me to see her because my father was blind. So I said, you must have seen something in her that I have not seen, so it should be fine with me. My father called me back and said, "You idiot, you don't have to see her, but she has to see you." So why this marketing? How do you take this for granted? Then she will like it. Really, that comes from him. So we went and met for 20-25 minutes. I came in June, saw her, and I tell you, we met for only 25 minutes or so. We have been married for 26 years. And in 26 years we have been married, I have never lived with my wife 26 days at a stretch because we got married like in the dean's office with my travel. Now the family lives in Chicago, I work in Bangkok. And so that in the marriage, what do you talk? I don't know her, never heard of her, she doesn't know who I am. So I just asked that question. I said, "If you could tell me one thing that you really like, and if that is not something I enjoy, or I will tell you what I like and you don't enjoy, then we are not meant for each other. There has to be something beyond work." She said, "What do you like?" She asked. I said that I love teaching. And as I said, teaching I consider as a, not as a profession. Teaching to me is something you heard him say. I really think teaching to me is going to a temple, is a worship. Honestly. So I said that I teach a lot. And sometimes I go to school at early in the morning, come late. So she said that I don't mind what you do, but during the day if you have a minute for to think about me, that's more than enough. We have lived together 26 years, we have three children. One thing that makes us successful, and I can speak we have, is the support we have at home. For Indians, the support you get from your spouse is the best you can get, which in many countries, it's not there. And so we are blessed to have the blessings from the parents, from our spouses, and I wish you the very best on your journey.
I now request